Got it. Right. So here I am going to talk about designing for accessibility, which you might also know as universal design or inclusive design. So first of all, I have a hand-waving exercise. Hands up if you're a, I'm trying to see if the light, if you're a developer here. Yeah, kind of guess that would happen. How about if you're a designer? Whoa, not many designers here. And how about if you're both? Anyone both? Okay. So I think that's wrong, anyway. This is rubbish. There is no such thing as a unicorn designer. I think that actually, if you're a designer, you'll agree with me on this, actually. If you're a designer, you should be able to write markup. Normally, I might say that, and I would be ousted. Like, everyone would hate me. But also, if you're a developer, you're actually also a designer. Because every single decision that you make affects the design of your product, your project. Everything that you think about from the very beginning of a project, every decision that's made, every problem that's solved over the duration of that project will affect the outcome, and that's design. So designing for accessibility, whereas I use the term design, isn't just for designers. What is accessibility? What do I mean when I'm saying this? Accessibility is the degree to which a website is available to as many people as possible. So if you're thinking about building design, you might think about wheelchair users, you might think about blind users, but then that tends to go, when people think about the web, hand in hand with this thought that accessibility is just about screen readers, but it isn't. So I have some questions to ask, rhetorical questions. I wonder really why people on the web don't seem to give much of a shit about accessibility. It's not some shiny framework. It's not some super button style. Is it because we don't understand who we're trying to help? Is that why we don't care? Is it because we just don't know what to do? Is it because it's too hard and that there's just too much to think about? I've not got the answers, and I'm not here to try to make anybody feel guilty. But I would like you to think about whether it's fair to have a web that isn't accessible, to create products that aren't accessible. I also have some good cases. So by not giving accessibility enough consideration, we are potentially excluding a huge amount of people from using our sites. So if I give an example from the UK, about 1 in 5 people are registered as disabled. That's only people that have registered as being disabled, so they get sort of disabled parking badges and things like that. And it's very much the same across the rest of the world. There are so many people actually affected by completely different types of disabilities. So I think that any design decisions you make in the name of accessibility will largely benefit everyone. The business case, which is what everyone wants to know when they're trying to convince their clients or their bosses about why accessibility is a good thing. So these are from a white paper from about 9 years ago. So if you think about it, this was before mobile became really big, before people started browsing the web so much on their mobile, before there were quite so many people on the web. So if these stats are true in 2006, think about what they could be now. So improvements in accessibility doubled Legal & General, big life insurance company, life insurance sales online. That's doubled. Improvements in accessibility increased Tesco's, which is a supermarket, their home delivery sales by £13 million in 2005. Improvements in accessibility increased sales on Virgin.net by 68%. These are all like mega corporations. This is huge amounts of money being made just through tiny little improvements and thought and consideration. By reducing your audience, you're potentially excluding all that income from those users. So looking a bit more into the different types of accessibility, what are we actually trying to deal with here? I think there are 4 main types of disability that affect our use of the web. There's visual, blindness, low vision, color blindness as well. There's hearing, so variations on deafness. There's motor difficulties, so this might be the inability to use a mouse, a slow response time, a limited fine motor control. And then there's cognitive disabilities, which might include learning disabilities, distractibility, like me when I'm using a computer and there's Twitter at the side of the screen, the inability to focus on large amounts of information, and that's probably me as well. And none of these disabilities are completely black and white. Here, this is the spectrum of deafness, and you can see that all the way through this, these are very different types of hearing difficulty. Like, I have a very mild hearing impairment, like incredibly mild, that I barely ever notice it, but it's medically there. All the way to being completely profoundly deaf and never having heard anything. That's an enormous scale there. And there's all these different types of things that can affect your eyesight. There's astigmatism, sensitivity, color blindness. Akinetopsia, I think, is where it's you're sensitive to the movement, things moving. I put up there to have a baffling one. And I think that when you think about these different types of disability, you can actually put them in very simple terms, in terms of the usability. So if you think about it, caring for visual disabilities, you're just trying to make your website or your app easy to read. With hearing, you're trying to make it just easy to hear. With motor difficulties, you're just trying to make it easy to interact. And with cognitive difficulties, you're trying to make it easier to understand and to focus. Good accessibility is just good usability. Of course, there are particular things you can do to cater to particular disabilities, the sort of the extremes on the scale. And that may be quite a different case. But if you're trying to just include as many people as possible, it's not too tricky. And if you just bear all of these things in mind, it will really help. I've got some examples here, and I have a little bit of a disclaimer. If you worked on any of these sites or apps, I'm very sorry. I found most of these by searching for the common problems just on Twitter, like going, bad this, search, and seeing what came up. So often this is actually from the mouths of other people, and some of them are things that really wind me up. But these are all things we can improve, and that's the important thing. It's just taking that knowledge and making things better. So on the matter of text, and I hope that this is okay on this screen. The Apple footer on their website, that text at the bottom in the footer is about 10 pixels high. You better have really good eyesight if you're looking for a job with Apple, because the only place you're going to find a link to the job opportunities is in that footer there. This website here, the Chicago Manual of Style, if you see how tiny their navigation is, it's a wonder that anyone can find their way to any of the other pages on the website. There's also a problem now with groovy web fonts that we all have. Very lightweight web fonts can be problematic because they don't render so well. They're very hard to read, sort of white text on a dark background. It can make it really thin, really difficult to read. Squinting does not make for an enjoyable reading experience. Oh, it seems obvious to me. So there's just a few basic guidelines that we need to think about when approaching text on the web. We want to make our text content easy to read. We want to ensure sensible font sizes, so it really does depend on the font that you're using. But generally, 16 pixels and up, you're going to be good. Don't prevent the user from resizing the fonts themselves in the browser. The browser takes a lot of the weight of the accessibility stuff. There are a lot of settings in there that people need to use on a daily basis to actually just get by on the web. So don't stop the browser from doing those things that they do quite well. And there's also very long line length. I love the Pastry Box website. But if you're reading it on a big screen, I feel like I'm getting whiplash in my eyes, constantly trying to have to read from one end of the line to the other because it's just so big. We also have some ambiguity, and I will be coming back to this one later, but click here. nobody knows where it goes. Making the meaning of things clear and using labels is also very important. iOS 7 is full of these bizarre use cases. So the weather app, generally quite handy, I use it loads. If you look at the top right-hand side of the screen there, what's 14 and what's 9? There's just no way of telling. I mean, you can just about guess. If you read further down the screen, you'll see, okay, so every day there are two numbers, and one's slightly darker and one's slightly lighter. So you could maybe just guess that it might be highs and lows. That's what I've guessed it is. It's the highest possible temperature and the lowest possible temperature. I might be completely wrong, though, because actually they didn't label it in any way. They thought that the minimalist aesthetic was going to be enough. They thought the beauty was enough, and it didn't actually have to be easy to understand. You need to think about what things are supposed to mean and how people use them. It might be very clear to you when you're stripping out elements to try and make things look trendier, but is it actually easy to use for other users? I think the good copy is part of good accessibility. You need to keep your text simple and your meaning clear. Color. And this is one of my favorites. I absolutely love color on the web. Very few people use it bravely. Unfortunately, when they do, they can often come up with sort of messy situations. So this is a pretty cool website from a couple of years ago. But the problem is that the use of the reds and the blues on this kind of weird, browny, greeny, beigey, gray background is actually really hard to read. This is a double whammy, this hotel website. They have brown on brown, nice and hard to read, and really tiny text. So very difficult. This is something that really comes to mind when projecting a presentation onto a screen. Your screen isn't the same as everybody else's screens. What you might design on a beautiful Apple display at home might come out a bit blurry and 3D-ish when projected in a cinema. You need to use color contrast tools. There's loads of them, and I'll show some later, to ensure your text is high contrast enough. And beware of really high contrast, too. So usually people's solution is, oh, I'll just jack the contrast up really high so it's all black on white. They never want to be able to read it. But actually, there's been studies into dyslexia, type of learning difficulty, that actually shows that with very high contrast, people with dyslexia find that very hard to read. It looks like it's dancing around the page for them. Content hierarchy. This is hard to read because it all just looks exactly the same. Just adding little things in there to show the actual hierarchy, and this could be reflective of the HTML that you use, makes it so much easier to understand at a glance what's going on a page. I think that people are often quite arrogant and assume that a user will read every tiny little bit of copy on their web page. That's never going to happen. So you need to point them out to the important bits. However, randomly enlarging and coloring text does not make it into a hierarchy. If you just have some kind of span and you make it bright blue, extra large text, that's not going to make it into a heading. You need to make your content structure clear and consistent and use semantic headings, labels, lists, and other relevant elements for your HTML or if you're using native apps or hooking into native controls. Make sure that you do that there as well. Links. This is all over the place. Why should I click there? Sometimes the links are the same color and the style as the rest of the text, and you only find out it's a link when you hover over it. Finding interactive elements should not be a game. I shouldn't have to sit there hovering over every little bit of text. You know, like how when you're young and you read with your finger underneath the word so you don't lose track of where you're reading. It's like that. It shouldn't be that hard to find links. I think that you need to make your buttons and interactive elements easily, distinguishable from non-interactive elements. Basically, make links easy to recognize by using an underline. It's been around for a very long time, the underlined link. Everybody knows what it is. You might think that you have a really cool new way to show what links are. You don't. There's a convention there for a reason. It works. Just stick with it. So back to this really great example that I have in the gym that I go to, their website. Just mysterious click heres. If you think about someone navigating your site with a keyboard or through a screen reader, and they're just cycling through all the links on the page, when they're just coming across a load of links that just say, click here, click here, click here, click here, how do you decide where to click? You don't know where it goes. You need to make your link text more descriptive. So the same here on this pet shop website. Here you can select a brand or click here to view all brands. Why not possibly make that link the entirety of click here to view all brands? And then someone actually tabbing through the page, reading it with a screen reader, will be able to see that that's where that link goes. It takes you to view all the brands. We need to consider why should someone click there. We need to use link text that makes sense out of context. And remember, actually, that not all your users are clicking. And this is quite a big thing nowadays with touch screens and all sorts of wacky other inputs. Someone could be winking with their Google Glass rather than clicking. We can't use this generic language anymore. We need to really sort of be broader in our thinking. And then there's alt text, a title text, and long descriptions as well. I don't know how well you'll be able to see this website. So this is a blight on the web, the W3 Schools website, which everyone loves. But there's just one other problem with them as well, just to add to the list. They have these little images, these little icons that have different pictures of browsers, and they put it by code examples to show you whether you can use it or not. If you're browsing this with a screen reader, you would just see the name of the browser when you hover over any of the icons when you're looking at what the images are. So you can see that this is Internet Explorer. You don't know whether you can actually use it in Internet Explorer or not use it in Internet Explorer, because the text just isn't descriptive at all. The person that's writing that alt text wasn't thinking about how someone might be using the website. They were just like, I'm just going to write what this is. And it's not quite the same. You need to consider the context in which people are actually looking at alt text. Now, this damn you autocorrect, which is very funny, but they haven't really thought about considering people with screen readers in this. So if you hover over it, the way of checking what the alt text is, you can see that this entire dialogue is just summarized as Bahamas. It's not so funny when you read it like that, really. I think that unhelpful alt text has its place on XKCD. Even then, you could use like long desk in a really cool way. Provide text alternatives for images that helps a user actually understand the context of the image. Media. This is a tricky one because it can be very expensive, but I don't want to listen to people's podcasts or watch their video tutorials. I just want text. And actually, search engines, they want text as well. It's not just people with particular needs. There's many different advantages to it. Providing text transcriptions for your audio and subtitles for your video. It can be pricey to do this, but it's so worthwhile for how inclusive it is. And really, if you're someone like me and you can't, like, you just don't have the patience to sit through a video tutorial, just having like the text there underneath so I can just follow it in my own time or skip ahead if I want to is much easier to use. JavaScript. Oh, the wonderful things you've all come up with recently. If there's a loading screen, there better be something worth waiting for behind it. Ads. I mean, they're a huge problem anyway, but don't make me wait for them to load before I can actually read any content. So not only is this coming up in my face when I'm trying to view the links that someone sent to me, but it's also, I have to sit there and wait on my terrible connection for the ad to load in the first place. Something like this you see quite often, where a page is oddly blank in particular parts of it. I don't want to wait forever to somebody's page to load just so I can see how many Facebook likes they have. Because this is what it is. It's this horrible pandemic of people that don't really understand how to use the sharing buttons, just sticking the JavaScript in the middle of the page, and then it's holding up everything else from loading. And I think that as developers, as creators of these kinds of buttons, these kinds of different things that we ask people to insert into those pages, we have a responsibility to tell people how to use those properly. Use JavaScript with care, load it in a sensible way. I mean, saying that to you guys is incredibly obvious, but I think it's about also passing it on to the people that are going to use your code. If your website or your app needs JavaScript, try to ensure you use Aria to guide the assistive technologies. There's loads of resources out there telling you about Aria. And I think that if you're getting to the point where you really can't use it, there you have a decision to make. Of course, you've got to strike a balance between what you can achieve for people with different disabilities. But sometimes, if you have a particularly complex app, such as if you were recreating Photoshop in the browser, yes, I think you may have a point there where you need to consider whether screen reader access is helpful or not. It's probably not that helpful. Navigation and wayfinding. If your navigation needs an explanation, it's probably not good enough. So I have to, I don't know if you can read that from here. Click and hold your mouse down anywhere on the site to access quick product navigation. It's not very helpful at all. This was one I came across the other week. Someone linked to, oh, this really pretty website. You wouldn't have guessed that the navigation was actually the yellow items on the screen. The days of Flash are over. Stop punishing me with your artsy navigation. JavaScript isn't just another way to do Flash. You need to provide consistent ways to help users navigate, find content, and determine where they are. That means as well for any other user, if they're just coming into your site from a link that's from Twitter or something, and they're not on, they've not landed on the homepage, just showing them where they are can make a huge difference. Forms. No one likes filling out forms. And making them long is kind of, it's a stupid thing to do, and we all know that. But it's things like this. How many forms have you seen like this? Something's gone wrong, but you have to guess what it is. Errors in, this is all, every single one of these errors is, what you've entered is in the wrong format. You shouldn't be showing this to the user. If it's in the wrong format, that's the developer's problem. The developer should either be ensuring that they can't enter in the wrong format, so that they're actually accepting all these different types of format and making it sensible, or just passing that error on to whoever's doing the admin, dealing with the content at the end. You shouldn't be showing this kind of rubbish. Don't make me guess what and where the error is. Animations. This is great. This is, as a role put, CSS animations are like Flash, but you can't turn it off. I really like Happy Cog are brilliant. They do some really inspiring things, but I was really surprised by this website when I was trying to read the content, and they've got this really odd background that's kind of flickering and flashing at you. You need to wait for me. Wait for me to actually read the content. I think you need to give your users enough time to read and use your content. Try not to distract them from their goals with the unstoppable animations. So I know that I'm going a bit over, so I'm just going to go through some really great resources, but I will put these slides online. Look at the accessibility guidelines for your relevant platform. That's always a useful thing to do. The Accessibility Project has some great resources if you want to get started. They've got good checklists on there as well that tell you how to do basic accessibility stuff. WebAx is a great blog where you can find out about all these tiny little details you'd never even think about. And Wave, which is by WebAIM, is this really cool tool that you can use to test your site against various guidelines and see how well they conform. So this is the what the tester looks like. And this is the kind of thing that it comes out with on my site. I have no errors, which is good, but I have four alerts, which is meh. The contrast ratio tool from Lea Veroux is really great for checking background colors and foreground colors against each other. Color Oracle is a really great tool that works on Mac, Windows, and Linux, so you have absolutely no excuses not to try it. completely free as well. And for this, it just simulates different types of colorblindness. So this is on my site, showing you sort of slightly different, really crazy different colors. People have said to me that they need proof that accessible websites aren't just ugly. So I just thought I'd have a quick look at running them through the tester. The LXJS site is a really good looking site and brilliantly responsive. Look at that, only 5 errors, and they're just spacer images, missing alternative text. That's like an old school error message there with a spacer image. I think that's actually caused by some icons further down. Because Jed works for Uniqlo, I thought I'd have a look at that. Uniqlo is a stunning website. And look at that, only 3 errors. That's really good for such a mainstream site. I looked at Estelle's site, which of course she knows a lot about accessibility. So hers came up really good with only 2 errors. And Robert, I think he wins the day with 0 errors. So that's very good. I think we need to consider accessibility at every point of planning. It is functionality, it's content hierarchy, it's copy, it's visual design, and it's code. I think we need to start considering accessibility as default. I think that we need to think about it in the same way that we consider performance. Everything we do impacts accessibility. Everything we do impacts upon performance. So we just need to consider it as part of everything that we're doing. I think that once you start considering it, it's much easier to think about it. Once you start actually caring, it will always be there in the back of your mind. And I have some accessibility cards to give out that just have these guidelines, which are kind of a plain English version of the WCAG guidelines. So if anyone wants one, they're only little business card size. Just come find me later. Thank you.